Hi, this video is part of a Coursera course which we are actually producing. If you want to know more, just check out the description where you can actually register for the Coursera course for free. If you find any flaws in the video, just comment below and I will do my best to address your concerns. Thanks a lot for watching and please don't forget to like, subscribe and share if you like the video. TensorFlow is an open source library for numerical computation and it's using data flow graphs. It allows us to express machine learning and deep learning algorithms and brings along an execution engine which allows these algorithms to run at scale on multiple nodes in a cluster backed by CPUs, GPUs, TPUs and mobile devices. So every numerical computation is a graph where the nodes are computations and on the edges are flowing tensors between them. Therefore the name TensorFlow. So let's start with a little coding example within IBM Data Science Experience. We create a new notebook. We give it a name and select the correct Spark service, although we do not need it at the moment. And then we click on Create. Make sure that Python is selected as programming language. So first of all, we download some data. TensorFlow has a couple of built-in datasets and we use the MNIST handwritten digit classification set. Now the data gets downloaded and we obtain a complex Python object called MNIST. Let's import TensorFlow first, but then examine the data we've just downloaded. We use the Jupyter Magic command matplotlib inline to display the plots directly in the notebook. Then we access the first image out of the 55,000 from the MNIST training set using a built-in iterator, which is quite useful for later usage, but now we just access one image at a time. Images in the MNIST dataset are 28 by 28 pixels, but we are only obtaining a vector of 784 pixels length. Therefore, we have to reshape accordingly. Then we tell PyPlot to plot grayscale and finally plot the image. So this is a 3, and if we run again, we see a 1. Note that every time we call next batch, we obtain a new image. Sometimes we are not really sure what number is meant, therefore we can also print a label. This is a 1 hot encoded vector. This means at the index of the actual corresponding number, we see a 1 and all the other elements are 0. Now let's start with the TensorFlow coding by expressing the static computation graph using Python. We start with a so-called placeholder. This is a tensor within TensorFlow where data is fed in during execution time. So basically, this is used to add data during training, which takes place after this computation graph is constructed. Those placeholders are typed and we can use either single or double precision. So this placeholder will take our training vectors representing the images with 784 elements in size. Now we create a TensorFlow variable. A variable is something TensorFlow will tweak during training, whereas a placeholder is meant to keep training data. In addition, a variable can be saved to disk during and after training for checkpointing and model transfer. So we create our weight matrix W with 784 weights on one axis. Just one for each element of X and we do it 10 times since we are basically running 10 softmax regression models in parallel, one for each possible digit. Finally, we end up with a bias vector, one for each softmax regression model. Now we create the actual model. So please be aware that no computation is happening at this stage. We are now basically hooking up the nodes together to form a computational graph. Softmax as well as Matmul expect TensorFlow variables as parameters. So that's the reason TensorFlow code is so hard to read. We are not computing anything, we just use Python to express a computational graph which is executed by the TensorFlow engine in the background. TensorFlow is not having its own domain-specific language for doing so, but is relying on language bindings in different programming languages, like Python for example. SystemML on the other hand, which is introduced in another module, is a bit better here, since SystemML is having its own domain-specific language in R syntax or Python, which looks far more natural. Anyway, let's continue with creating another placeholder for the training labels Y. These are of dimension 10 because y is a one hot encoded vector labeling the image. Now we define the cost function as cross entropy. Therefore, let me just walk you through the formula and we will see later how to implement it in TensorFlow. So we take a predicted value of y hat and multiply it to the log of the desired value of y and sum those values up. So we start with the reduced mean function of TensorFlow because we are now calculating 10 individual cross entropy values, one for each softmax regression model. Then we use reduced sum to calculate the sum over individual values of a tensor. And this tensor is the product of the desired value and the log of the actual prediction. Reduction indices defines the dimension of the tensor where the aggregation should take place. Since Y is a matrix of 10 columns and n rows, where n stands for the number of training examples, we sum over the columns to obtain a value for each digit. This result is now passed to an argument to reduce mean so that the overall prediction error is calculated out of the individual prediction errors for each number between 0 and 9. Now we use TensorFlow's gradient descent optimizer with a learning rate of 0.5 to tweak W and B with respect to the cross entropy function. So TensorFlow will take care of calculating the backpropagation and gradients for this task automatically. A feature called automatic differentiation does the job for us. Now we create a TensorFlow session. Since we are in an interactive context within a Jupyter notebook, we use the interactive session. A session is the way to deploy a TensorFlow execution graph onto a specific execution context like a CPU or GPU. Then we initialize all global variables since this hasn't been done. Remember, we just have only expressed the computational graph. Now it's time to bring it alive. After the variables have been initialized, it's time to create our gradient descent loop. So this is batch gradient descent, since on each iteration we grab 100 randomly selected examples from the training set, and using the session object we execute gradient descent for those 100 examples. Note that we pass the training examples as parameters to this function call in order to assign them to the previously defined placeholders. So this runs very fast. Now let's evaluate our classification performance using the test set from MNIST. So argmax returns the index of the tensor, in this case a vector, which the maximum value. This way we can transform back from one hot encoding scheme to a scalar. We use reduce mean in order to determine the amount of correctly predicted values. But since correct prediction is a Boolean vector, we have to cast it to float in order to calculate the mean over this vector. And again, accuracy is a node in a computational graph. Therefore, we need to use a TensorFlow session in order to execute it. Now the placeholders become handy because now we assign the test dataset to the graph. And as expected, this simple regression model gives us 92% of accuracy. So as you have seen, training of neural networks can be quite complicated, but it's okay if you didn't understand all. In the next module, we will cover TensorBoard, a visual way of debugging your neural network. Thanks a lot for watching, and please don't forget to like, subscribe, and share if you like the video.